Well, we've had an absolutely fantastic night here tonight at Northwold Primary in Hackney as part of the Mayor Trust. Really, really grateful to the school for allowing us into the building tonight, but more importantly, bringing the community in to discuss how we educate our children and how teachers, parents, local artists and businesses might come together to start reimagining what education might look like for the fourth industrial revolution as it comes down the line. We're in a very, very special school where things like this are going on, and hopefully we'll hear that from Alison in a minute. I saw another amazing head teacher here. Is Nick Osborne around? Give us a wave, Nick. Where's Nick Osborne? Here he is. Nick from Millennium Primary. I saw him do a talk in a conference. He was talking about the whole year structured around the apprentice. Children making, researching, presenting, renting cinemas, amazing work. A lot of bad language in that movie. A lot of bad language, I should apologise. Things like creativity, project-based learning, mindsets, absolute disgrace. There's one newspaper in the UK which I've got a lot of time, a lot of respect for. Shane, the publisher's here, and Laura's the editor of Schools Week. Can we have a big round of applause for Schools Week for the support for not just here tonight, but every week with the publication. They've exposed a lot of stuff. They write a really good, strong newspaper. Laura, ex-school teacher herself, writes for The Guardian. So Laura, have a microphone. Who else have we got on the panel tonight? Alison, you're going to join us on the panel here? Alison Creel. Big round for Alison again for being so generous with the use of the building. And her whole team. John Williams, the author of Screw Work, Break Free. I'll have some of that. That sounds fantastic. John, big round for John. I met John in a cafe in Soho, and he'll woe that day. Annie, the editor-in-chief of Netmums. Annie's here. Big round for Annie. We have got to get this conversation out of education echo chambers. That's preaching to the converted. Annie's here representing the mums. Is Dominic here? Dominic Wilcox. Big round for Dominic. One of our really, really generous creatives. He runs a project called Little Inventors. The United Nations have now picked up. He's taking that to countries around the world. Done amazing work with Dominic and Sundan. Sophie here somewhere, is she? Sophie. I've known Sophie and her husband, Shane, for several decades. She runs one of the coolest digital curation creative leadership organizations in the world, if not in Shoreditch. And Madeline Holt. Madeline's a mum at my son's new school. Big round for Madeline. She's here representing more than a score. Madeline's a tireless campaigner for creativity and has been an amazing support over this. Laura, over to you. Microphone there. If you could share the microphone between three of us, a switch on that.
Thank you.
And that's it. Go for it.
I'm going to stand up, not least because I was a school teacher and I haven't taught for about 3 or 4 years when I came here earlier. See, even that is classic. When I came in here earlier, I immediately moved into assembly mode and I could feel the way that I was starting to walk down the empty then hall, looking around as if I was going to tell somebody off about their uniform. So I do all hope you have your shirts tucked in. We have this fantastic panel. Just to help us think a little bit through some of the issues in the film, I have to say, Nick, it's great that you've said about me being supportive. I'm going to be honest with you. I sat at the back with my head in my hands. This is not my kind of film. I actually found this quite challenging. However, I think you have a panel who are probably more sympathetic, and that's good because I may end up challenging you a little bit and asking you some questions and getting your thoughts and feedback on the film as well. In fact, Alison, it would be really helpful to start with you because you're a head teacher, and one of the things that came out in that was this idea that schools currently forget that they're full of humans. Ken Robinson said that a couple of times, and I wondered whether you thought that was correct.
No, I don't think it's correct at all. I think there are cases where there's a real danger of thinking that every school's the same, and there's a multitude of different types of schools and different types of personalities and all those sorts of things. But everyone I know of who's gone into teaching is because they're really interested in that human connection. So I don't agree with it.
What was your sort of takeaway then from that film?
There were some things that I really, which has made me think. There was an awful lot that I already recognised. So at the very end, they actually stole one of my lines, which is that we are actually trying to create schools and create a curriculum for society, and the jobs haven't been invented yet. But there are lots of things that got missed out. So, for example, they talked about sort of being worried about the middle classes. And as somebody who came from a very working class background in South Africa, black working class, the curriculum that my parents would have wanted for me would have been very, very different to a white middle class family. And so we need to remember that all of the curriculums that we're creating, there isn't a one curriculum suits all, because we all come from very, very different places. I think that they also missing the point about the fact that the economy is changing, and that the superpowers in terms of who's got money and who hasn't got money, we're looking at places like China, India, Brazil, all of those sorts of places, their education system is very, very different to the system that we've got at the moment. Therefore, if we are... when I talk to the children in the school, I always talk to them about thinking about where they're going and the fact that they've got to be independent and resilient and not dependent on the state. And I always talk to them about the fact that when we look in assembly, if we had 100 children, about 25 of you will probably get a job in this country. And the rest of you are going to have to think really, really long and hard about how you're going to do that. So a lot of them will be going to where there's money in the future. But the way in which they've constructed their education system and all those sorts of things is really, really different. So how are we going to get our children to be able to fit into that society and belong and all those sorts of things? So it's not straightforward. It's not straightforward at all. But in terms of creativity, yes, I want our children to be independent and innovative and to be able to work collaboratively and to understand each other and to respect each other and all of those sorts of things. But there isn't a straightforward curriculum for all.
Thank you. I wonder if we could speak to Annie, if you could pass a microphone over.
Thank you.
You're down on my list here as a mum's mum, so representing parents, if you like. And in that, there was a certain amount of nervousness from parents that if you were to send your child to a school that didn't focus on tests and didn't focus on exams, that could have a negative impact in the future. Do you think that if England suddenly decided to become more creative with its curriculum, that parents would get quite concerned?
That's a tough one to answer, actually. I started watching the film thinking exactly that. Mums are going to like throw their hands up in the air and be like, oh my God, no way, we're never going there. But actually, the more I watched it, the more I felt that it actually tapped into some of the themes that we see when we're talking about education on NetMums. So NetMums is the biggest parenting site in the UK. Education, interestingly, is one of the things they care about most and one of the topics where if we write about, we get the highest levels of engagement. And the things that they are most interested in aren't necessarily high grades anymore. We are starting to see lots more engagement around the topics of how can I motivate my child? And this number one thing that, in fact, is quite interesting, as I was kind of keeping an eye on the news at the back of the room, Gary Lineker has come out tonight and called for a national ban on homework. Now, homework is a massively emotive topic because parents at the moment tend to feel that it is there to drive high grades and performance in terms of SATs and stats overall. And parents are increasingly involved in doing homework with their children and are finding that it's becoming a massive burden on family time and a massive burden on their child's psyche. So I think this film might actually tap into something quite fundamental in them, which is something that they can see in their own children, that the kind of the drive for stats and results and exam success isn't necessarily working on a very basic parent-to-child and family level.
Do you think, though, there was a slightly surreal scene with Brian, I think it was.
Oh, Brian.
Who looked like he was about to be sick because the next day he had to hand his project in and he hadn't done it yet. And I sat there and I thought, is this more humane? If Brian was sat up the night before his A-levels looking this ill, would we all be going, that's terrible, this is awful? But because somehow if it's a play or if it's a football match or if it's an exhibition, we go, oh, no, this is great, this is very character developing. Why would parents think that's okay, but him doing that for an exam is too stressful?
I don't know if they thought that was okay. I'm a mum, and that really made me nearly cry.
Really?
Absolutely.
So why is that?
The thought of a child being under pressure, whether that pressure is from external factors or internal factors, isn't something that sits comfortably with any parent, I don't think. I think we all struggled with the Brian in that. None of us would... want to see our children there in the summer holiday carrying on doing it.
Yeah. Okay. I can see Sophie sort of doing this motion over there. If we can grab this microphone and just pass it down, I'm interested to know why you were rocking backwards and forwards at that point.
Is that on?
Yes.
Okay. I guess because I thought what he went through was really positive. And if you took a test and you failed it, you're not passionately going to sit there and take the test again, and then you pass the test. But if you look at kind of what he learned, and my emotion towards it was just like, go on, Brian. Like, that's amazing what you learned, and you did it. And you did it passionately. And I guess, for my opinion of the film, I kind of watched it and thought it was amazing. But then, to give a bit of context why, I'm a mum with two boys, so my experience of school is 4 and 7, so I haven't got to the testing process yet. But then I also run a digital agency. So I deal with lots of graduates, and we do a lot of work in universities. So I deal with how they come out after going through all the education, spending, coming out with thousands of pounds in debt. And I question a lot the value of what they're doing at university. We started a education program called Cascade, which is about collaboration and going into universities and getting people to collaborate and doing education in a different way, but for graduates and undergraduates. And I think some of the soft skills, when I get applications for my company, I don't look at where they've been to university. I look at what they're passionate about and what they're doing with themselves. And I look for projects they've involved themselves in over and beyond what they've done at university. Because I don't necessarily think that going through that process for 4 years is a kind of a true reflection of maybe what that person is.
That makes total sense. I'm interested in this split in the room. So it sounds like some people felt that the Brian stress situation was bad, and some people feel that it was quite a positive thing.
Or some of us thought both.
Or both. Well, I'm going to come to
and
this
that's
and
the
and
split.
Thing. But can I just get from within the audience to start with, and I'm going to get some questions or some thoughts from the audience. Who thought that Brian going through that, it was kind of a bad thing and it was quite stressful? Interesting, because I think if he'd been doing an exam and had looked like that, lots of people in this audience would have thought that it would have been quite problematic. So that's interesting. I'll come to you for a sec. Anyone who thought it was really positive? So lots of people thought the stress was quite positive. If you can grab this microphone and
I'm a mother of three, nine, seven, and three. And I think it's a very different thing when it's self-driven. Sorry, is it close enough, man? When a project like that's self-driven, he really wanted to do that. It wasn't the structure of the project might have been imposed, in inverted commas, by the school, but the responsibility he took on was all of his own. And I think there's another dichotomy in society that we now have, which is the sort of tiger mom and the overprotective parenting, where we don't want to see our children, in inverted commas, suffer. And we don't want to see them suffer for something that they're not passionate about, but the endurance that you gain from going through something like that is actually a massively important learning skill for life. So we have this overprotection kind of element, and it goes into all walks. It's the same as whether we let children use knives or real tools of the trade, or actually get their hands dirty with things. And for me, that's one of the big problems with the state education system, is that we're infiltrating this kind of sense of what children's capabilities are, and we're limiting them from our own fear of protecting our children. So for me, it was sad to see him, in terms of obviously the emotion, but it came from him and he got through it.
Brilliant. Thank you. I know I've not come to all the panelists, and I will come back to you, but Alison, I just wanted to pick up on that as someone who's a head teacher. Is how do you feel the balance in primary school at the moment is between opportunities for students to experience perhaps positive stress in an exam situation versus other situations?
We actually go out of our way to the children can find, yes, life is stressful, and so what we talk to the children about the fact is that stress is normal, and how we handle it is what's really, really important. And that's one of the reasons why we spend so much time teaching our children skills like mindfulness. So we do mindfulness several times a day and so on. And when we talk to them about exams and things, we want them to understand that it's not them, it's us that we're interested in. But it's for them to understand what they're really good at, so that I think that what we've got to do is to try and help our children have positive self-esteem. And if you've got that because you know you're good at something, and then that's what drives you to be successful in other things. So I don't want a school where children think that a successful learner is someone who's really good at maths or someone who's really good at English or science. Because I know plenty of people, when you talk to them about school, they felt that they weren't successful learners because they were rubbish at maths. And that's just not true. And that's why we see so many people who are creatives, who are doing amazing things, and maybe failed at school because their definition of success was very, very narrow. So we try to offer a very broad and rich curriculum where the children have an opportunity to find out what they're good at. And once you know what you're good at, you can then feel good about yourself as a learner. And even if you find maths or English or whatever it is really, really difficult, you have the skills to be able to cope with that. So, but I know that we're not doing it the same as everyone else. And I think that there is a danger in this country that children are truly, truly believe that it just comes down to SATs and exams and all of those sorts of things without really thinking about the fact that life is made up of a whole range of skills and they need to develop all of those.
Thank you. I've got a couple of questions and I've been pointed out here. So the first one is Nick Osborne, who is from Millennium Primary here. We'll get you the microphone. What was your thought?
I just wanted to pick up on the stress angle that was raised. So my name's Nick Osborne. I run three primary schools in Greenwich, but I'm a dad as well. So we do cross over. We're not just one or the other. And the thing we do in our schools is we're very passionate about sort of big outcomes, apprentice style. And I think actually when you live in the Western world and you live in the UK, people talk about stress a lot, but actually we don't really experience that much. Bit controversial, but we don't wake up in the morning worrying if our house is going to be blown up. So actually, and I see stress as a good thing sometimes with how we work. If you go to a fairground, the best ride is the ride that's going to scare you first. You go on it and you come out at the other end and you're exhilarated. And that's what we try to do in our schools. So we don't try to kill them or anything. But we'll give... The whole topic will be something that they cannot do at the beginning of it. So, you know, the beginning of a year four topic might be to create their own restaurant evening. Or I'm sitting here watching this thinking, why don't we put on our own movie events or things like that. So you want them to have this stress, you want them to have the problems, and then you want them to learn to solve it. Because you're absolutely right. We have no idea what the jobs are going to be in the future, but if we're used to having to work our way around things, then that is sort of real creativity.
John, you and I were talking about this earlier because you've written a book about this issue, and I mean, how do you feel that school can prepare people for a future in which they're going to have some stress, but hopefully not too much, but they are going to need lots of different skills, and we can't necessarily say what that's going to be?
Well, I think the skills that they're going to need are different, and you're still going to need to be able to think logically and understand the world. And I'm a big fan of science and people who can spell and construct a sentence correctly. So I still believe in all those traditional things. But I think the relentless testing and the focus on just cramming your head full of stuff that apparently falls out shortly afterwards is not a very good idea. And what's actually going to be needed is, in a time when robots and AI and people in another country who are probably a bit more enthusiastic than you will do it for less money, then you need to be teaching something else. And the things that can't be replaced by technology are creativity, caring, initiative, collaboration, those kind of skills. So you still need to be able to do something when you're being creative and collaborating that's useful to the world and use some intelligent thinking behind it. But you need those things because this is happening really fast. And I think at the moment, we're not seeing too much of it, particularly in the middle classes. But it is happening for people in traditional manual labor. It's disappearing. And it's going to have a seismic effect. It's going to be, it's already, I think, contributed to things like Trump and the Brexit vote. There's more going on there than just that. But it's contributed to quite shocking results for those that were unexpected by a lot of people. And And that's because people are finding that they're losing jobs in manufacturing. But when we see, and other things like that, but we're also seeing things like, you know, that software that can write a simple article for a newspaper. We're seeing software, the same IBM technology, the modern version of it that was shown in that program, is now being used to do legal research for lawyers. And in general, even quite skilled people are becoming commoditized. So we're seeing global marketplaces for skills that are really pretty sophisticated, but someone somewhere else can do. So then it becomes a prize game. And what happens is those things that used to guarantee you a really nice middle class lifestyle are now sinking further and further. And the only things that escape that kind of commoditization are initiative and starting things that didn't exist before and going from zero to one, something that never happened
before. But do you think, if I was, let's say I was a 24-year-old now living in Hackney and I'm a driver in a warehouse and my job disappears because it's been automated. Do you think that if 8 years ago when I left school I had had this type of classroom versus the type of traditional classroom, I would be any different?
I don't know. I think that's a really good question. I think for those people who traditionally did fairly repetitive work, manual labor, that kind of stuff, I don't know what's going to happen. I think someone ought to be worrying about it right now, who is running education and running the country, because it's such a big problem and we're a little bit sleepwalking into it. And then what happens is that when a huge great swathe of people lose their jobs and they feel powerless, then they, will clutch at straws for things that might make their situation better, a la what we've seen in America right now, and much worse around the world, who say that, who point the finger at immigration as being the problem when it's not primarily. So I think we need to resolve that, and I don't know the answer to that, but I do know for anyone above that level where there is something skilled in your work, then you definitely are going to benefit from being able to initiate things. And what I do is I run programs with up to 300 people at a time around the world online, making an idea happen in 30 days, their own idea. So largely something that could become a business or it could become a creative project. And what I'm doing is I feel I'm filling in the gap of what they didn't learn at school. And the effect is transformational. In fact, there are people who have done it, I think, or at least one person, Nikki. Oh, right, you've done as well, cool. So, and people rave about it, and part of it is because they go through the Brian experience in the middle. So they have a meltdown where they realize they've got to, produce something and show it to the world. And it's amazing. You wouldn't believe the people who have good careers and very smart and able in the world who find it so difficult to show themselves, to say, I've created something, and I've got an idea, and what do you think of it? And I think it's partly the education system that has contributed to that.
Would you mind if I asked you some questions about that? Just to completely put you on the spot in front of a room full of people. I don't know if the microphone is around, thank you. Because I was just going to ask you, so you did the programme, but I was going to ask...
Oh, Nikki as well.
And somebody else has done the programme as well. But you did the programme. Did it give you something that you felt educationally you hadn't had before?
Yeah, thank you, John. It was a couple of years ago now, actually, and I have been through the education system. I went to university. I started off as a journalist at the Daily Telegraph, and I've been through sort of a very interesting time looking at how media has changed and communication has changed. And being a journalist in those early days, 20 years ago now, for me, there was a certain arrogance about the fact that you were quite important and that people listened to you, and actually, taking yourself out of an environment where you felt that you perhaps knew the answers and actually challenging your own idea and then presenting back was really uncomfortable at times. I'm actually sat next to my first client, who's a good friend as well, but it just encouraged me to think independently and to build something on my own.
Do you think that that's something that you need to do as an adult, though, rather than necessarily as a child? Or do you think that if we changed schooling to be like it was in the film, that people wouldn't have to go through that as an adult?
Sorry, yeah, no, absolutely not. I'm a mum as well, so I have two children. And I am certainly of the side that Brian actually had a very fantastic experience there because he learned something about the real world. And to your point, you know, it wasn't just a test that he failed and it was hidden away, it was embarrassed, it was something to forget about. It was something that he learned, he built, and he learned a great deal. And to see his face at the end of that, for me, was the most poignant part of that film. And I want that for my children, and I want them to create. I don't want to tell them what to think. I want them to go out and learn to process information in their own way and be creative with it. So I'm passionate about education, and I'm passionate about creating something new. So it was a powerful film.
Thank you. I know we've got another question or comment. Is it Lemu Sisse?
Yeah, Lemu Sisse. Thank you. Oh, I had just a comment, because Nick asked, my name's Lem Sisse, I'm Chancellor at the University of Manchester, I'm a doctor twice, I've just come back from Redbridge where I gave the keynote address to 60 head teachers from Redbridge, and I haven't got a GCSE to my name. I've got no qualifications. Creativity is not the monopoly of artists. It's available to everybody. A mother is creative in how she or her or the a father solve a problem for their child. This program, for me, was not about saying necessarily that the other system, whatever other systems are used, are bad. It is in itself an opportunity for us to take a good look at why creativity is important and what systems have we assumed that must be right because they are there and therefore we work within those structures. This allows us to be able to actually look at the structures that we've already we're in and see where the faults are, because there are faults. And I just want to just so that the argument is, the discussion is not binary, it's not them and us. This is an opportunity, and yeah, obviously you're already doing that here. And I also wanted to say that everything is built from the imagination. Absolutely everything has to be imagined first. So what is real? Is it this physical building? Is that real? Or is the fact that it was imagined and then became a physical thing, is that real? There has been a lobby against the idea that imagination is not real. Does that make sense? It's really important. It's a really big idea. So that means that to imagine something is as real as it actually being here. And that's empowering for people.
It is. I'm going to ask you, though, if yes. I was one of the head teachers and you'd said that to me today in Redbridge, I would have gone, right.
Yeah.
When I go back to my school, what should I do with that information?
And I would say that's all about aspirations. If you are about to say to a child that what they imagine they can achieve and that everything that is around them has to be imagined first, what you're saying to them is that they have the possibility of being the person that makes this physical. And by the way, it being physical is secondary. The first thing is to do is to imagine that it can be done. To devalue imagination is to devalue the aspirations of the child.
Thank you. And with that, I'm going to go actually to Madeline, because you have this campaign of more than a score. And I think when we're talking about devaluing in particular, one of the things that you seem quite passionate about is, you know, would it be devaluing a person almost to just say, well, you're an A-grade student or you're a pupil? Is that kind of...
I guess what More Than a Score is about, and we've only set it up in the last couple of months, is it does tap into some of that, but it's more specifically about getting rid of SATs, because we think they're damaging to people's creativity, to their confidence, to pick up on what you said, and the mental health issues that young children are experiencing now are rocketing, and it's got to stop. So what's interesting about More Than a Score is it's kind of got together organically in the last, as I said, last few months, because I think that parents' attitudes are changing. There's two big parents' groups on this alliance of about 12 people. There's Let Our Kids Be Kids that you might know about from the children's strike last year, and also Rescue Our Schools, which I was involved in setting up. But there's also the NUT and experts in child well-being, and primary school experts and academics. So it's a whole coming together of people who are professional, you know, who are here, and then parents who I think, as some people have said here tonight, are starting to question some of these assumptions. I've got two of my children at secondary school, but it's interesting that more and more people that I know are saying, do you know what, I don't really care if my child doesn't go to university. There's no jobs, the stress is too great, the debt is too great. All I hope for is that my child comes out of education as a rounded, creative person who has not lost their marbles. Because, you know, I hear all the time about kids who are 14, 15, 16, who you think are really sane, and then suddenly overnight, they lose it. And it's very, very troubling. And we see it now at primary school level. So I love the film because it was preaching to the converted for me, because I think there's a totally different way of seeing education, and it's not about so much these measurable outcomes. All the things that matter are the things that you can't measure.
Can we not imagine a world where we do both, though? There was a slightly cheeky scene in which one of the guys says to the kids, what would you like? Would you like to be taught how to do your exam, or would you like to be told real-world practical skills? And I thought, well, can we not just put an and in the middle of that sentence, but and it would be okay?
But there's an irony. There's a school, I used to be a TV reporter, and we've made a launch film for our More Than Score thing, and the irony is, and it's sort of picked up here at the end of the film, we went and filmed at a primary school in Suffolk called Beelings, and it's totally... like this, you know, they don't do any SATs papers, they don't do any homework, and they came top of the SATs in Suffolk just a few weeks ago. So, you know, that's the big irony. You can teach in a way where the kids are interested. You know, I don't think any of this is that new. I mean, people, teachers will know in the 60s, child-centered learning was all the rage, 60s and 70s. And so it's been so heavily criticized politically and made into this ridiculous dichotomy between knowledge-based learning and skills-based learning and standards versus creativity. Why can't we have creativity and standards? Actually, it works. It's the most effective way of doing it.
I completely agree. And I'm going to come back to you in terms of moms and net moms and your kind of info on that, because as many parents as probably are thinking that they want their child to be creative and they maybe want a ban on homework, do you also get lots of parents, though, who want private tutors for their children and are pushing to get them the best test results?
Absolutely. Coming back to what this mum said earlier, we have got this massive kind of split at the moment between parents, between these tiger mums who are basically searching on net mums for tutors and tutor recommendations 24/7, and then the people who are starting to realise that, you know, SATs and all of that isn't going to be the thing that produces the most robust child at the end of the day. And the two almost seem at war. Some of the fiercest debates that we have in the Net Mums Forum among parents fighting those educational kind of standpoints out amongst each other, and there really is a split. There is a very fierce split.
But sorry to bother you, I think the bridge, though, is creativity, because I have a child at a primary school that's where there's a lot of this tutoring going on, and there is, as you say, you know, the stress to make your child this person who's going to be like a kind of phone with loads of apps. But also, when you start talking the language of creativity, they like to think their child is creative, and that's, I think, the way into it. And plus the mental health issues. At my children's school, a quarter of the children, when they took SATs last year, were in tears in year six. And so out of 60 kids, after the reading test, I don't know if anyone here had experience with that, this was when the SATs were made pass or fail last year, which is what they are now, 15 of them sat there crying.
I'm going to bring, if it's all right, Dominic's not spoken yet, and I want to pick up on this point, because you're an artist and a designer and inventor, and actually I'm wondering, in terms of creativity, is it straightforwardly that we should teach creativity and by letting people do what they want, that's how you get the best out of them? Or is it some kind of balance, or in fact, do you need lots of knowledge before you can be creative?
I think someone was... I watched. I'm new to the world of education, so I'm sort of catching up on what's the current situation. But I know there's this idea that knowledge is the gateway to creativity, as though, and that is the excuse for just teaching the knowledge. And once the children have got all of that knowledge, they can use that to be creative. But actually, creativity is a state of mind, and
you can, so, I mean, I can talk from my perspective. And by the way, I am Brian, who grew up and lost his hair because I have been stressed every project. So I recognize Brian's pain, and it will continue, Brian. I am sorry. You have found your passion, and it will continue now that you've found that passion. anyway, what was I talking about? Yeah. So I understand. When I get a brief, I'll have to really understand the subject, learn everything about it, learn all the information, and then I'll let it settle into the back of my mind, forget about it, and the next day, little shoots of connections between knowledge will link up. So actually, creativity, if you talk about STEM, science, technology, engineering, maths, that's great, and history and geography, etc. But creativity and innovative thinking is the ability to link, to make links between those subjects on their own. If you just know the information, you do nothing new with it, and computers can know that information. So I don't know whether I'm going off track here, but knowledge and creativity can go need to go in hand in hand. The knowledge is very important, but the idea that you can just gain lots of knowledge and then, actually, what I was going to say was, which has been on my mind, that I think some people believe that you're either born creative or not. So you've either got it or you're not. So you can actually leave it alone and teach the information. And then with the belief that at the end of the school, they've got all of the information and you're either creative or not. So your the creative people will be able to use that information or not. But actually that's completely wrong. Creativity is a state of mind. It's a way of thinking, and it can be taught, and I know it because I'm doing it. And once you lose it, once you lose that way of thinking, of being creative by just learning the information, it's difficult to get it back. So that's why children, like I'm targeting primary school children, because they've got this free, wonderful imagination. Then they go into comprehensive school, and sometimes it seems to die off because they become self-conscious and worried and pressure, and they go in on themselves and they lose confidence. And I'm losing my track, but
I think, yeah. I mean, is what you're saying that, and you're right, absolutely right. At the moment, government thinking is knowledge is the most important thing. That's the bit that we can do well if we have 30 children in a classroom with one person, and creativity will come along. And I think what you're trying to say is there are perhaps situations you can put young people in, like Brian, that help him keep that state of mind.
It is a state of mind, which I think is very important to maintain.
And I've got Alex Bell, who is from the RSA, who wanted to give a comment. I don't know if it's on something similar or potentially a slightly different point, but Alex is at the back. Maybe you could come in on that.
Yeah, I work with the RSA, and also I've got my own consultancy called Portland Education. And I think one of the things that I try and do with my work is to reconnect. By the way, I'm an ex-head teacher as well, so, and a dad. It's got lots of races. One of the things I want to do is to try and reconnect people with their purpose. And I think what was very hopeful about that film is it showed that it's possible to do that. And I think what really is very discouraging when I work with schools is sometimes the adults working with the children have lost their sense of purpose, and therefore they're role modeling that as well. And I think, you know, whatever flaws we see in what High School High is doing, I think they very clearly are working out with the children what their sense of purpose is. And I think if we're sort of having AI and outsourced jobs snapping our heels, I think one of the things we need to do is work out how to be more human and how to work out how to educate for a life well lived, amongst other things. I think exams are part of that, but I think that sense of well-being and everything else needs to come back into education where it's been pushed out for a long time.
Alison, I don't know if there was something you wanted to pick up on at this point or a little earlier.
First of all, I want to say that there are some schools where they misunderstand the whole SATs process and maybe children do get more stressed, but that's not the case in every school. And I went out of my way to speak to our children and ask them if they found things to be stressful, and they said no, and I'd by all means talk to them. And the reading test was the reading test. And what was really interesting was the number of children who found that reading test. If you know the SATs paper, the second bit was extremely hard. And there are some children who wouldn't go past it because it was too hard, whereas our children missed it out completely, went to the third bit, and then came back to what they couldn't do, which kind of thought they were just in a different place. We've got some Dutch visitors who came in this morning and have come back this evening because they liked what they saw and they spent a lot of time talking to the children. And the children are very confident, but that's got to come from somewhere. They've got to believe in themselves and they have to have those opportunities to grow and develop and do all of those sorts of things. And also, SATs aren't pass-fail. It's just an indicator of where children are. There is a change.
The government have put one in. You don't have to tell the children.
If you don't get a certain score, you get a little bit of paper saying that you are not secondary school ready.
Okay, I don't know about that.
Even the NAHT, that if you look on their website, it's...
But I think your point is that you can do it differently, right?
You can do it differently. The other bit is that there are... I think that you need a balance between children. I think what we need is a range of different types of schools because we've got lots and lots of different types of children, and it's really important to say to parents, choose a school that suits your child. So lots of parents will come to me, it's just like, we really, really want my child to come to the school, or there's just this normal thing that if it's right for one child, it must be right for the next child. Don't do that. Find the school that suits your child. And as a mum, my daughter is unbelievably different to me. She's a musician and she's dyslexic. And if you find reading easy and then you've got a child who's really dyslexic, you kind of see, okay, that's a different world that they're going into. And so it was really important to find a school. The school she went to would never have suited me. And that's a really important thing to learn. And the other bit is that there is a slight change in the way in which children have been assessed now, in that we've got greater depth. And I think that is a really exciting development. So we're not looking for children, we're not looking for a tick list where they know this, this, and this, and this, and this, okay, yes, you go to the next level. What we say now is you get to a stage where you're learning a bit more, and then you learn to apply and use those skills independently. So if you look at the way in which reading's assessed now, it's not decoding. Reading isn't decoding. Reading is inference and being able to understand the world and to have an opinion and to read a range across a range of different things. So there are nice changes coming on. Whether or not schools embrace it in the same way, that's a whole different story. So just choose the place that's right. And I think that's what I felt watching that more than
sounds like you feel it's possible perhaps that schools could start with that knowledge base but certainly get to a place where things are more creative.
You can do both, but there are some schools that will go down the high school high route, and there are other schools that will, you know, we've got Mossbourne down the road, and that's one of, yes, exactly. That's one of the highest performing schools in the country, and it's very rigid, very, very rigid, and that's how they've got the results that they've got. But it's not right. There are parents who will be terribly upset because their child didn't get a place in that school. And I'll say, well, maybe that was the right thing because your child might not have been happy there. So it is really about getting the right balance.
Thank you.
And it's not straightforward.
We are now at 9:30, and the teacher in me and the fact that I am in what is equivalent of an assembly hall is going to be quite strict on time. But I do want to leave you with me being slightly more, perhaps, look at this, a bit left-wing minded, I do want to just end on this Minister for Exams. I don't know if any of you have ever heard this poem before, but it was certainly in my teacher training. I am quite a big exam fan. You might have picked that up. But this has always stayed with me, and I think it probably blends together lots of what's been said here and lots of whatever side of this debate you're on, I think everyone can understand this. And I'm only going to read the end of this poem because the beginning sort of gives it away, but this bit is what it's called, the Minister for Exams, and it says, Question 3, why do snowflakes melt? I wrote, they melt because they fall onto the warm tongue of God. There were other questions. They were as simple. I described the grief of Adam when he was expelled from Eden. I wrote the exact weight of an elephant's dream. And yet today, many years later, for my living, I sweep the streets or clean the toilets of the fat hotels. Why? Because constantly I failed my exams. Why? Well, let me set the test. Question 1, how large is a child's imagination? Question 2, how shallow is the soul of the Minister for Exams? So if we can all go away at least agreeing on that one and give a great big round of applause to our panelists.